We're going to look at a story. I was doing some review when I preached this message back in, not the same way, it's a little different this morning, 2002, January 13. And when I preached this message, there was a recession in 2000. The dot-com bubble burst, 9/11 took place, and there were some shady guys who crashed the banking system, and the country was going through some serious pain. The unemployment in 2002 was 5.8 or something like that percent, and we were in a recession. It was a short recession. We suffered a little pain. It was like for 8 months or 9 months, and then the economy recovered. You see, today, our unemployment rate is 14.8%. From 3 point something to 14.8. And by next month, it should be going up to about 20 something percent. Amen? So there's a lot of folks hurting right now. There's a lot of folks hurting right now. And we need to stay strong. Amen?
Amen.
We've been hit economically. We've been hit with viruses. We've been hit with dereliction of leadership. I mean, there's so much stuff going on right now that we, as the children of God, we have to pray. Amen?
Amen.
And we have to stay grounded in Jesus. Amen?
Amen?
Let's turn our Bibles to the book of 2 Kings, chapter 7. And we're going to read from verse 1 to 20. Not all the way. I'm going to be preaching from this story. And when you found it, stand. If you're at home, you don't need to stand. That's all right. Amen. Verse 1 says, "Then Elisha said, 'Hear me the word of the Lord. Thus saith the Lord, tomorrow about this time, shall a measure of fine flour be sold for a shekel, and 2 measures of barley for a shekel in the gate of Samaria?' Then a lord on whose hand the king leaned answered the man of God and said, 'Behold, if the Lord would make windows in heaven, might this thing be?' And he said, 'Behold, thou shalt see it with thine eyes, but shalt not eat of it.' And there were 4 lepers, men at the entering of the gates. And they said one to another, 'Why sit we here until we die? If we say we will enter into the city, then the famine is in the city. And if we shall die there, and we shall die there. And if we sit here, we die also. Now therefore come, let us fall on the host of the Syrians. If they save us alive, we shall live. And if they kill us, we shall die.' And they rose up in the twilight to go unto the camp of the Syrians. And when they were come to the uttermost part of the camp of Syria, behold, there was a man there. There was no man there. For the Lord had made the host of the Syrians to hear a noise of chariots and a noise of horses, even the noise of a great host. And they said one to another, 'Lo, the king of Israel hath hired against us the kings of the Hittites and the kings of the Egyptians to come upon us.' Wherefore they arose and fled in the twilight and left their tents and their horses and their asses and even the camp as it was and fled for their life. And when the lepers came to the utmost part of the camp, they went into one tent. They did eat and drink. They carried then silver and gold and raiment and went and hid it and came again and entered into another tent and carried thence also and went and hid it." Amen. "Then they said one to another, 'We do not well. This day is a day of good tidings and we hold our peace. If we tarry till the morning light, some mischief will come upon us. Now therefore come that we may go and tell the king's household.'" Amen. We'll hold it there for now. Father, we thank you, we bless you, we worship you, we adore you, and we honor you, and we ask your blessing upon this word in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
Let me give you a little background here. The king of Syria had surrounded the city and sieged the city. There was a siege. No man could go out and no man could come in. So what the king of Syria was trying to do is to starve the people in the camp so that they would either give up or they would die. So people were suffering. People were hungry. That even a donkey's head was being sold for $80. Amen. People were eating stuff that, like in Haiti, there are some folks hungry. They make mud with grass for food to stop the hunger. Things were so bad that the children of Israel had turned to cannibalism. One woman made a deal with another woman and said, today we're going to eat your baby, and tomorrow we're going to eat your baby because we're hungry. And the first woman said yes, and they boiled the baby. This is not story. This happens because of the children of Israel's bad behavior towards God. And the next day, the other woman came to the woman's house and said, now is your time to boil your baby. And she wouldn't do it. Hallelujah. So the woman went to the king and complained that she boiled her baby, and now she's hungry, and the other woman is holding on to her baby. And the king got so mad with the prophet of God, he said, this, I'm going to kill that prophet, because his God is what's causing famine in the land. His God is causing this problem. The king said, go and cut off Elisha's head. And the swordman was on his way to cut off Elijah's head, and Elijah said, God tell Elijah that the king is sending the assassin to take off his head. And Elijah opened his door and said, you come to kill me? Tell the king what thus saith the Lord. Amen. Here's the word of the Lord to the king. Tomorrow, say tomorrow.
Tomorrow.
About this time shall a measure of fine flour be sold for a shekel, and 2 measures of barley for a shekel in the gate of Samaria. Hallelujah. That is the prophetic word from God. Hallelujah. There was no grain, no field to plant any grain. Yet the prophet said, tomorrow the marketplace is going to open. Come on, somebody. And grain's going to be sold like it used to sell. Hallelujah. God said it. And if God said it, it's going to happen. No matter what it looks like. Hallelujah. When God speak a word, all we need to do is believe the word. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. 2 Chronicles 20:20 says, and they rose early in the morning and went forth into the wilderness of Tekoa. And as they went forth, Jehoshaphat stood and said, hear me, O Judah, and ye inhabitants of Jerusalem. Believe who? In the Lord your God, so shall you be established. Believe his prophets, what? And so shall you prosper. Hallelujah. Our prosperity is not dependent on no government. Come on, somebody. Our prosperity is not dependent on the job that pays us a weekly, whatever, bi-weekly salary. Our prosperity is dependent on our God. Come on, somebody. So I don't care what is going on around me. Hallelujah. I don't care who is shut up. I don't care who is running crazy. If God says tomorrow, hallelujah, this time, grain gonna be sold in the marketplace like it did before. Even though it don't look like that, it's gonna happen.
Amen.
Because when God speaks, hallelujah, miracles happen.
Hallelujah.
And all we have to do is believe.
Amen.
Simply. That's our responsibility. So God says, believe the Lord your God. and you shall be established. You shall be strengthened. You know one of the problems that's going on right now? Many of us don't believe God. We believe everybody else, but we don't believe God. We believe with our head the word, but we don't believe with our hearts. And we don't believe the man of God. Amen. And God says, our prosperity is dependent on believing in him and believing in his prophets. Amen. Hallelujah. There are good prophets and there are bad prophets. Some of them, you know, you don't listen to them. Amen. God said, by their fruit you'll know them. Amen. Praise the Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Believe. Hallelujah. And you will receive. Doubt and you will do without. Amen. God has not changed.
Amen.
He's still the same. He is a faith God. You must believe. And when you don't believe God, God get mad. Amen. Listen to this royal official, this government man. Listen to what he said to the prophet. And verse 2, and then the Lord whose hand the king leaned on, meaning the king depended on him as a counselor. Amen. Listen, if you're not getting counsel from God, your counsel not good. Amen. He answered the man of God. He was out of order and said, behold, if the Lord would make windows in heaven, might this thing be? He's saying, I don't believe it. That's what he's saying. In front of the king, in front of the people, in front of everybody. Say, Elijah, Elisha, what you say don't make no sense. It's nonsense. Hallelujah. Can God send rain overnight and cause the field to grow overnight and give us, hallelujah, corn? Yes, he can if he chooses to. But God didn't tell him how he's going to get the grain. Hallelujah. God didn't tell him. All you need to do is believe what God says. You don't know how God's going to operate, but you believe and say, yes, Lord, I believe. I receive. I believe. You know, there's a attitude in church. Some people believe that they'll accept some things, but the pastor said, oh, accept other things. I remember, you know, many people... Sometimes, you know, I share some stuff for them and some of them say, I receive it. And some say, I don't receive that. I don't care if you want to receive it. If it is coming from God, you better receive it. If it's coming from me, it don't make no difference. Amen. These men, these prophets, Elisha, Elijah, Samuel, these men were powerful men. Amen. I don't see anybody on earth right now walking in their footsteps. Amen? None can compare to these men. Not one of their words fell to the ground. Everything they say came to pass. And even though they were accurate prophets, even though they were good men and great men, the people that they prophesied to didn't believe them. Can you believe that? They see the hand of God working in these men's life, but they still don't believe. Amen? What did he do? What was the man doing? The man was sowing doubt and unbelief into the hearts of the people. The man is sowing doubt and unbelief in the hearts of the people. People can cause you to walk in fear and not in faith. Who are you listening to this morning? Are you listening to the voice of God? Are you listening to your friends? Are you listening to ungodly people to get your guidance? You can either walk in faith or walk in fear. And there are people around you who will either speak faith in your life or speak fear in your life. Though they love you, they mean good, but they're not speaking faith. If they're not speaking faith, ignore them. God sent 10 spies to spy out the land he gave. 12, thank you, Pastor Gene. To spy out the land he gave to the children of Israel and say, this is what I want you to do. Go and look and see for yourself the evidence that this land is flowing with milk and honey. Go and look for yourself that the land I'm giving you is a flourishing and prosperous land. 12 of them went, and 10 came back with a negative report, and only 2 came back with a positive report. 10 of them say, yes, the land is good. Yes, the fruit them big like my head. Come on, somebody. And they're, you know, the mango them so succulent, and the pomegranates or whatever you call it, and the grapes them big. Hallelujah, glory to God. Hallelujah, everything look good. Everything is as what God says. But shut up. But shut up. But here's the but. Here's the fear that they talk. But there are giants in the land. Hallelujah. And they have the Canaanites with chariots. And we are grasshoppers. And we look like grasshoppers unto them. Whatever you look in the mirror and see yourself, that's how you see yourself. And they believe that's how the other people see them. So guess what? They instill fear in the hearts of 3 million people. And the 3 million people start to cry and say, Moses, we're going to stone you because you bring us here for them to kill us. Those 10 men destroyed the people with fear. What should have taken a month for them to inherit their inheritance took them 40 years because of doubt and unbelief. And this wicked royal man was sowing doubt and unbelief in the hearts of the people, and God was mad with him. When you have made up your mind that you're going to doubt God, and you're not going to believe God, you're not going to walk in faith, there is nothing anybody can tell you to change your mind, because fear already controls you. So guess what happened? Two men of faith stood up, Caleb and Joshua, and said, hey, stop crying! Stop crying! We are more than able to take the land because God is with us. And guess what happened? The 3 million people ignored the two men of faith. And they went to their camp crying and decided they're going to get another leader. They're going to switch the leader because he brought them into the wilderness to kill them. That's what doubt and fear and unbelief will do. Will cause you to make wrong and rash decisions. Amen? And when you speak doubt and fear and unbelief in people's life, God is not happy with it. And you know what God says? 10 times these people have tried me. I showed them my power. I showed them my glory. But they still won't believe me. So God says, you know what? Since you think I am such a wicked person, and I brought you out here to kill you. You know what? Not one of you of this generation shall enter into the promised land. All of you are going to die first, and you will never see it. Don't get God angry because of your fear and your unbelief. There was another man named Zechariah. When God sent the angel, and the angel act like God, you know, it's like God. When God tells you something and you want to doubt and not believe him, God get upset. So the angel came to Zechariah about 80 something or 70 whole heap. And in white boat, 70 whole heap. And say, you've been praying all your life for a son, and I'm going to bless you with a son. And the man said to Gabriel, the angel, Gabriel, you talking to me? I almost 80-year-old, and my wife brushing all that. Are you going to tell me, say, I will have a son? And the angel get upset with him. And the angel say, you know who I am? I am Gabriel. I stand by the throne of God. And God sent me to give you this good news before he said, thank you, God. You're questioning me. You know what happened? You're going dumb for a season until the boy born. You're going to be dumb. You're not going to talk because you're talking nonsense. You're not talking faith. You're talking doubt, fear, and unbelief. So I'm going to dumb you. And guess what? People wonder, how come Zechariah don't come out of the thing and talking? Them see making sign. Hallelujah. Hey, if you make God mad, he'll make you give sign language instead of talk. And shut you up because you're trying to destroy his plans. And Zechariah didn't talk until the naming service. When John was born. When John the Baptist was born, and everybody wanted to call him Zechariah, the mother said, no, God tell you to call him John. And they said, nobody in your family named John. Hallelujah. And then the father, who learned him lesson, because the 9 months the boy in the mother's womb and growing him can't talk, him come and say, Mama said, hello. No talk. God closes speech, took away speech. Because of doubt, fear, and unbelief. And they say, give me a piece of paper to write on. They never have paper them days, they say,
Maybe.
Tablets. Hallelujah. Parchment. And him write down the name John. And the people say, John? And as soon as he write down the name John, God release him out. And him speak and praise God and bless God. So, unbelief is a terrible sin. Doubt is a terrible sin. God might wink at it sometimes, but there are times when God will judge it. And this man, the royal man, here's what the prophet said to him in verse 2. He said, behold, thou shalt see it with thine eyes. But what? You shall not eat thereof. Why? Because he questioned the power of Almighty God. Who are you, you little shrimp, to question God's power? Amen. You see, if you don't understand what God is doing, shut up. You might get God on his wrong side. One morning, I mean, God don't have me on the wrong side, you know, but I see God judge some stuff sometimes that I wonder why I'm judging it that way, but he's God. Amen. Amen. He has to show us an example, because this man was saying, you can't do it, God. Is there anything too hard for God?
No.
Is there anything too difficult for God?
No.
You know, on my job right now, my boss is fearful of losing his job. And he's spreading that fear to everyone that's under him, including me. I had to realize that what he's doing is instilling fear. Because, you know, we might lose our jobs if we don't produce the numbers. We need to do this, we need to do that. And for 2 weeks I was in a funk. Almost getting depressed because this man was pumping so much fear in me. So much fear in me until I realized who I am. Hallelujah, glory to God. I am a child of God. And so what if I lose that little job that God gave me? The same God that gave me a job, he will give me another job. Come on, somebody. Who knows that maybe he says time for you to come out of the secular world and go into full-time ministry. Praise the Lord. We don't know how we're going to pay the bills, but guess what? I have not been paying my bills for all these years. God has been paying it for me. Come on, somebody. He's been supplying all of my needs. So we'll not let no uncircumcised Philistine fill my heart with fear who don't know my God. Hallelujah. With God, all things are possible. With God, there is nothing too hard. And my God is able to do exceeding abundantly above all think according to the power that worketh within me.
Amen.
When you're walking by faith, some people think you're reckless. Some people think you're crazy because they don't understand that you're walking by faith. Hallelujah. And let me tell you something. When you're walking by faith, that don't mean bad things will happen to you. Hello, there's a lot of people who walk by faith and die in faith. Come on, somebody. And there are some people who walk by faith and live in faith. It don't matter when you're walking in faith and you know who God is. You don't care one way or the other. Come on, somebody. Hallelujah. You're going to do what God says. Hallelujah. Peter asked the question when they say, you must not preach in the name of Jesus because you're working too much miracles. You're healing too much people. Too much people getting saved. Don't you preach in that name anymore, or else we're going to lock you up, we're going to flog you, hallelujah, we're going to do all kind of stuff to you. And Peter says, what do you think I'm going to do? Who should I obey? Should I obey God or should I obey man? I'm here to tell you, my friend, my brother, my sister, I am going to obey God than obey man. Hallelujah, because the arms of flesh will fail you, but God will not fail you. You see, judgment for some people, he's swift. And judgment for some other people takes a very long time. the prophet, who is God's mouthpiece. On Wednesday I told you, the prophet can bless you, or the prophet can curse you. The prophet can speak good over you, or speak judgment over you. When he is walking in that anointing of God, he don't care who you are. He don't care what your face look like. You see, some people don't want pastor to talk to them too hard. Some people don't want pastor to correct them. But if pastor don't correct you, who going to correct you? Hallelujah. Bible says, who as many as I love, what? I chasten, I rebuke. Because guess what? Rebuke and chastening will lead to repentance. And repentance will lead to salvation. Amen. When God rebukes you, because God loves you. Amen. Hallelujah. He contradicted God and spread fear and doubt and unbelief among the people. And Elisha, behold, thou shalt see it with thine eyes, but shall not eat of it. There's something about spiritual fathering. The prophet Elijah was a powerful prophet. He called on fire from heaven. He worked a lot of miracles. And Elisha was his servant. You see, before God elevates you, you have to learn to serve. Amen? And he was his servant. And guess what happened? The same anointing that Elijah walked in, Elisha walked in it. He got, you see, Elisha wasn't following Elijah for money, because he didn't have any. Most of the prophets back in the day didn't have any money, but they had a lot of God. Come on, somebody. Hallelujah. But he had something that came from heaven that Elisha wanted, and that was the anointing. The anointing, the power of God. And he got it. So when Elisha spoke, you see, why there is so much nonsense going on in the house of God and the kingdom of God right now? It's because people not seeing things happen like they used to happen. You see, this prophet, not only was he a prophet, but he had the gift of faith that whatever he tells you is going to happen. There are few men like that on the earth, and God only raised up a few of them in a generation. That when they speak something, it happens sometimes immediately. And the prophet look at him and say, you questioning me and God? Because of that, you're going to see what God is doing, but you will not enjoy it. And the Bible says, and there were four leprous men. Say, leprous men.
Leprous.
Hallelujah. At the entrance of the gate, and they said one to another, why sit we here until we die? You know, the last time I preached this message, I said, don't sit there, do something. Amen. But this morning I want to change the topic, and the name is Make Something Happen. Come on, somebody. Amen. Tell somebody, make something happen.
Make
Hallelujah.
Happen.
Hallelujah. You see, sometimes your situation is so dire. Amen. If you go that way, you're going to get hit. Come on. If you go that way, you're going to get hit. So you have to make up your mind what are you going to do. So the four leprous men, and you know what a leprous man was? A man whose skin is rotting off while he is alive. And he cannot go near anybody because it's contagious. A leper was not let into the city. He was an outcast. And when he walked near anybody, he would have to say, unclean, unclean, unclean. I wish we had enough testing going on in America. Hallelujah. That way the people them come around with them corona and say, Corona! Corona! So we know how to stay far from them in the name of Jesus. Because there's some irresponsible people going around in town in the name of Jesus. You see the woman at the park, I went to the park yesterday. I have on my mask and everything and doing my and not about 90% of the people had no mask on, playing basketball, old people, young people, walking together, breathing in each other's face. And I said, Jesus have mercy, what a wicked set of people. Hallelujah. Glory to God. I wish We could have a test everywhere that they can say, Corona, Corona, so we know to stay far from them. Because they're the ones who's causing this thing to spread more than anything, because they're not taking no precautions. Because they think they're invincible. Let me tell you something. Whether your name Christian or unchristian, or you're anointed and appointed, let me tell you something. Disease is no respect of person. You better take care of yourself.
Amen.
I don't care how they go home of this country, no. Let me tell you something. The truth is, until people stop afraid of corona, they don't come out. You could open up all your bar, you could open your salon, you could open your movie theater, it's going to be empty because the people don't trust the government, the people don't trust what they're doing, the people see the incompetence of those who are supposed to be leaders, they have no confidence. Until that is restored, church go empty. Hello, hallelujah. The only place that have a lot of people is this grocery store. Hallelujah. People still have to buy food. Amen. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. You see, we normally go to Jamaican restaurant on a Friday for food. And this Friday, my wife says she wants something different. So Sister Colette will be telling about this DoorDash, DoorDash, DoorDash. I have no idea who this DoorDash is. Who the heck is DoorDash? So I said, okay, look at this and see what you want. So I put the app on the phone, the DoorDash thing, and she decided she wanted some Outback steak and stuff. So we ordered some Outback steak, and instead of going to the Jamaican restaurant, we ordered some Outback for dinner and thing. I specifically, right, put the food on the ground. I will come out with my gloves and pick it up.
Hey, ring the doorbell.
Knock me door, me not the ring bell yet. Hold it back, I try to put it on. I said, put it on! Hallelujah. Put it down! I don't know where your hand coming from. Some crazy people out there, man. This man come deliver something for my wife from a place called Berlin. First of all, my mind wasn't working right that time. I said I rebuke him. First of all, he masked down so I could see him nose. He had my gloves on my hand. And me so stupid. He take the pen but the man have and give me the pen. I said, Mr. J! I run inside and I wash my hands. You gotta be careful. You're not fearful, but you're careful. Amen. So when the young man look at me, and because I dealt with him harsh, I said, put it down. And look at me. Then I said, Pastor Gina, go down. I said, don't touch it. Don't touch it. Food can kill you. So I got my little paper towel or whatever and just hold it up and carry it in. I still have a little piece of the ribs left. I'm going to eat it this evening. Thank you, Jesus. But you got to be careful, not fearful. Amen?
Amen.
For 3 weeks, almost 2.5 years, I stayed in my house and afraid to go outside. My company want me to. I said, hey, no, you better fire me. I ain't going nowhere. Until I decided, okay, you know what? I can't tell on my yard forever. I got to pay my bills.
You gotta go out.
I gotta go out. So guess what? I look at the television, and I see the president having a news conference, and the news reporter them 6 feet beside, and they sit on the same room with their mask on. Huh? Them getting tests because I forget tests, but we can't get no tests, but we have to take care of ourselves. So guess what happened? I make sure, say, if I go on the road, because I have to go on the road, because my office didn't close down my office. They only say, don't come to them office. But you can go see your customers, go sell something. So I make sure, say, I have on my mask. My hand is in gloves. I have my hand sanitizer in my car. When I finish using gloves, I throw it away and I sanitize. And when I go home, I wash it. So guess what happened? You got to adjust. This gonna be with us for a while. You got to adjust. Amen? So here are these four lepers sitting at the gate discussing, hey, we're going dead one way. Hey, if corona gets you, something's all getting it. So I tell you, you may come home. So I said, why sit here until we die? And he said, if we say we will enter into the city, then what? The famine is in the city. We shall die there. And if we sit still, we also will die. Now therefore, come, let us fall unto the host of the Syrians. If they save us alive, we shall live. And if they kill us, we shall but die. Tell somebody, make something happen.
Make something happen.
Don't just sit there and die. You're going to make something happen. Make a move somehow. Amen? Tell you something, church. If your company is not functioning the way it's supposed to function, you might have to find yourself another skill. Come on, somebody. You might have to find yourself to do something else. You got to think how to survive. Amen? Hallelujah. You working in the healthcare field? If they're putting your life in danger, you might have to say, hey, look, I ain't coming back here. All right. I'm going to take my month vacation. Because you're not giving me the PPE that I need, and you endangered my life. Amen. I cannot bring back another life. I can't find another job. Come on. Hello. Praise the Lord. Thank you, Jesus. That's my mindset this morning. If my company were to say, because I'm not producing that I'm supposed to produce, and they want to let me go, all right, I will survive. I don't want them to let me go, Lord. I have to work, I have to go. But at the same time, I cannot paralyze myself and thinking about these things. One day at a time. Amen. Sweet Jesus. I only need faith for one day to get you one day. I don't need to think about what will happen tomorrow. Amen? Amen. Praise the Lord. And they rose up in the twilight. You know what time is twilight? To go unto the camp of the Syrians. And when they came to the uttermost parts of the camp of Syria, behold, there was no man. Say, no man.
No man.
No man was there. This was a big army. And the four lepers went to the army, hoping to get some food, hoping to see them and beg them and ask for mercy. And guess what? The camp was empty. Lepers. Lepers had to sit outside the gate. They couldn't come into the city. They were outcasts. And some of you sometimes feel that way. You're not into the inner circle. People don't accept you in their inner circle. But guess what happened? God can still use you. Amen? Amen. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. They could not go inside the city. So, you see what the leper situation is? They were sitting outside the gate. And as a matter of fact, they were even too close. God not even supposed to be near to the gate. But because nobody wouldn't let them in, and the people who used to give them food, they have no food to give them anymore. So they're hungry, they're dying of starvation. Do you know who would get killed first if the Syrians attacked the city? The four lepers. Amen. God, they were right there outside the gate. They couldn't go inside. Hallelujah. Because the law of God says no leper can come inside the city. They have to stay outside the city and announce unclean. They were starving to death. Like everyone else in the city, they were starving. They had no food. You see, the devil shut off their income. The devil shut off their supply. And they were locked up in that place and couldn't move. They were quarantining and couldn't move. Hello, somebody. They couldn't go anywhere because if they dare walk out, they die. The Syrian army killed them. And if they stay inside, they're going to die because they had no food and the water running out. Isn't that a dire situation? Church, I'm warning you today. Save up your little money that you have right now. Don't blow your money, because we're going to go through a rough time. Amen? We're going to go through some rough times coming up in front of us. Prepare yourself. Save your money. Amen? Don't blow it, because we don't know what's going to happen down the road. Amen? But prepare yourself. They came to the realization that if they do, they have to do something. Say, I have to do something.
I have to do something.
Amen. I'm not going to sit there and roll over and die. I'm going to do something. Hello, somebody. You know, there's a woman in is it Texas or Colorado, wherever it was, who is a hairdresser. And her city tell her she must shut down her hairdressing parlor. Now, she can't make masks. And she can't do anything to help herself. So guess what happened? She defied the city. Because she said, you know what, I have four children. And I have to feed my family. So I have to do what I have to do to survive. So she ignored the ordinance of the government and the mayor and the governor. And they locked her up and put her in jail. Because she was doing hairdressing work. I mean, she was taking one client at a time by, you know, do whatever she thinks is safe. But because the ordinance says you cannot do it, and she disobeyed, they went as far as to jail her. Until there was an outcry, they released her. And she's still doing her business, not as much, but she's still surviving. You see, these are tough decisions, you know. Very tough decision. But she had to do something. She said, you know what? I have a choice. Either I lock down my business and go to business and my children starve to death, right? Or I change the way I do business, the way I used to do business. I used to have people coming and walking. No walk-ins. I have appointments only, one person, and we're going to stay at work. And that's how she did it. She did something. So you know what they decided to do? They decided to throw themselves to the mercy of the Syrians. They may get some food, but if they don't get some food, guess what happened? They're going to die. But guess what? It was sure much better than sitting outside the gate with an away. Hallelujah. Either you sit on the gate and do nothing, you will still die, right? If I go to the Syrian, they might say, you know what, let me throw my bone. And if I die there, at least I made a move. Say, I made a move. Hallelujah. You see, making a move doesn't necessarily mean you're going to be successful. Amen. Making a move doesn't necessarily mean it's going to work out the way you want it to work out. But at least you're trying. Come on. Amen. Tell somebody, try. Don't die. My God, my God. They went twilight. And you know, I wasn't sure what twilight meant. Twilight is either sun up or sundown. But in this sense, in this case, it was sundown. It was between night and day, in the evening. And they went to the camp. They moved from the gate to the camp. Say, you might have to relocate your position to get your blessing. You know what happened? Verse 5 says, read it. Is it for the Lord, or six, verse six maybe? For the Lord had made what? The host what? Of the Syrians to what? Hear a noise of chariots, a noise of what? Horses, even a noise of a great host. And this is what the enemy said one to another. Lo, the king of Israel hath hired against us kings of the Hittites and the kings of the Egyptians to come upon us. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. What did God do? God made them hear like a army coming. And guess what happened? This drove fear. Say fear.
Fear.
In their hearts. Hallelujah. May God fear drive fear in the heart of your enemy this morning. Come on, somebody. May God take fear out of your heart and drive fear in the heart of your enemy so they scatter and flee. So when God let them hear like an army coming and horse running, and I'm telling you, I don't know how God did it, you know, but boy, God make the enemy make it sound like a big army coming.
Amen.
Hallelujah. And this is what the enemy said. This is how fear operates in you. When fear takes you over, you start to think a certain way. And as you think a certain way, guess what happens? You act a certain way. So guess what happened? This big, big army, when they hear the big noise of horses and chariots and all these things. They say, you know what? It looked like the king hired the Hittites and the Egyptians to come and beat us up, and they all pick up foot and run away. That's what fear will do. How could the king of Israel hire anybody when he's dying of starvation? And furthermore, Hittites are Gentiles. There's no way they would hire Hittites. Maybe Egyptians, but Hittites? Oh my God, no way. But this is how fear operates. Let fear in the name of Jesus operate in the heart of your enemy, and faith operate in your heart this morning. Amen. Say thank you, Jesus. Look at this. All of that noise that the enemy heard, not one Israelite heard it. Nobody has heard it. Amen? Because they were still hiding in the city. Hallelujah. Starving to death.
Not even the four men heard.
Not even the four lepers heard what the enemy heard. All they were thinking is that I'm dying of hunger. I'm going to go down to the camp and beg some food. Hallelujah. That's all they were thinking. But at least they made a move. So they make a move. Hallelujah. Don't just sit down and your hand make a move. In the name of Jesus. Israel is sitting here because the song was for the ears of the enemy to cause them to panic. Say panic. Say, Lord, let my enemy panic. Let my enemy confound. Let my enemy be confused in the name of Jesus. The question I want to ask you this morning is, why is the church panicking? Don't we know the God we serve? He never sleeps. He never slumber. Hallelujah. He has everything already figured out. Hallelujah. Why is the church panicking? We are the children of God. We will not panic. Amen. Amen. Jesus said in Luke 18:8, when the Son of Man cometh, will he find faith
in the earth
or on the earth? Will there be faith? You see, without faith, come on somebody, it's impossible to please God. Without faith, it's impossible to please God. God is not pleased when we walk in fear and doubt and unbelief. I don't care what type of fear, what type of doubt, what type of, no matter what type it is, there is no justification for a child of God to live in fear or live without faith. Amen. We are children of faith. Amen. Thank you, Jesus. When we are worrying, fretting, getting anxious and all bent out of shape, do you know what we are saying? We're saying that God cannot do it. You know, while we are worrying and fretting, wouldn't you like to know what is going on in the head of your enemy? Wouldn't you like to know what God is putting in the head of your enemy? Huh? My God, when you're worrying and say, oh Lord, I cannot do this, I cannot do that, this is too much for me, would you like to know what is going on in the head of your enemy? Your enemy is more afraid of you than you think. Come on, somebody. Say, thank you, Jesus.
Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah.
I don't want to go into that one, but you can read it when you go home. Read about Gideon. When God sent Gideon into the camp of his enemy to hear what the enemy was saying, to give him some faith to go and defeat them. Amen.
Amen.
Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. And they said one to another, lo, the king of Israel has hired against us the kings of the Hittites and the kings of the Egyptians to come upon us. So they flee and left everything. Lift your hands. May God cause the enemy to flee from you right now and restore everything that he has stolen from you in the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. In the name of Jesus, receive it now. Hallelujah. They fled. Hallelujah. For their life. Hallelujah. I want the devil to flee this morning in the name of Jesus from you. Every attack, hallelujah, in the name of Jesus. Every attack on your home. every attack on your mind, every attack on your marriage, every attack on your relationship, every attack on your finances. In the name of Jesus this morning, I pray that God will cause him to flee, hallelujah, from your home. Flee from your children. Flee from your mind. Flee from your homes. Flee from your finances. Flee from your job. In Jesus' name, somebody give God praise.
Amen. Hallelujah.
I got to rush it a little bit more. So, just to give you a little synopsis here and to close it up. The lepers went into the camp and they ate their belly full. They had a belch, and then they took some gold and some money and they hid it. They went into another tent because there's a lot of food and a whole heap of stuff. And they ate some more and they sit down and they relax. And all of a sudden, if you read the rest of the story, their conscience bothered them. And they say, you know what? And it's more than conscience. Fear also gripped them because they say, you know what? If people shut up in the camp, dying of starvation and hunger, and hear that we fill our bellies all night and didn't say a word to anybody, hallelujah, they're going to kill us. So they say, you know what, let's go and tell the king. And they went and they tell the king that they have found food. Hallelujah. So they call the porter of the city and they told him, saying, we came to the camp of the Syrians, and behold, there was no man there, neither voice of man, but horses tied and asses tied and tents as they were. And he called the porter and they told it to the king's house with him. So here they sent to the king. Verse 12. Here's what the unbelieving king says. First of all, you have the unbelieving porter who's influencing, royal official that's influencing the king. And you have the unbelieving king who didn't believe the word of the prophet. Here's what the unbelieving king says. I will now show you what the Syrians have done to us. Still don't believe God. That say God said tomorrow this will happen. He still don't believe. They know that we are hungry. Therefore they are gone out of the camp to hide themselves in the field, saying when they come out of the city, we shall catch them alive and get into the city. And one of the servants answered and said, let some take, I pray thee, 5 of the horses that remain, which are left in the city, because the horses were dying of hunger too. Behold, there are all the multitude of Israel that are left in. Behold, I say, they are even as all the multitude of Israel that are consumed. And let us send and see. Say, let us go see.
Let us go see.
The king was a doubtful king. He did not believe God or his prophet, yet God still provided. You see, even when you don't believe, come on somebody, God will still do it. Come on somebody, that's the kind of God we serve. Even though the people didn't believe him when he said tomorrow you're going to have food, and even though the king didn't believe when he said tomorrow you're going to have food, God still did it. Amen?
Amen.
Hallelujah. But you find that there's a little man or a little woman who will try to push you along. Look, sometimes people are looking for help from people in high places. But guess what? God sent help to from 4 lepers. Don't look at the vessel that God is using to bless you. Come on, somebody. Just receive it from God. Amen? And now this big king, the head of the whole nation, who had no faith. He was a fearful man. He was a doubtful man. And he said, you know what? These Syrians trying to trick us. Even when God tell him, tomorrow this time you're going to have food, plenty, plenty. The market will open again. And one little servant, no name servant, say, what do you have to lose? Make a move. Say, make a move.
Make a move.
Go look and see. Oh, hallelujah. If what the leper say is true, instead of sitting down and say, oh, you're not going anywhere, not because I don't believe. Hallelujah. These Syrians hiding at, oh my God, shut up. Hallelujah. One servant had a little faith and said to the king, let me go and at least see what these lepers are saying is true. Sometimes that's all God wanted to do, you know. Yeah? Confirm it. That's all he wanted to do. Hey? Sometimes all God is asking of you is, even if you initially don't believe everything, you're not even curious to find out, to confirm it. Where's your curiosity? Are you willing to step out in faith, even if you don't understand? Hallelujah. Come to Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. You have to step. Say, make a move.
Make a move.
Make something happen.
Make something happen.
In the name of Jesus. The judgment was fulfilled. Look at verse 17, and then I'm going to wrap up here. The people went out, and they spoiled the tent. They went out and they gorged themselves. And the king appointed the Lord, on whose hand he leaned, to have charge of the gate. And the people trod upon him in the gate, and guess what happened?
He died.
As the man of God said, who spake when the king came down to him, guess what he said? Hallelujah. As he came to pass, as the man of God, don't you doubt the man of God when he's speaking under the anointing, had spoken to the king, saying, two measures of barley for a shekel, and a measure of fine flour for a shekel shall be tomorrow about this time in the gate of Samaria. If God said it, come on somebody, it must happen. And that Lord answered the man of God and said, because of his answer, what you say, hallelujah, the Bible says, hallelujah, glory to God, by your words you'll be justified, and by your words you'll be condemned. And this man spoke against God's word, and he paid the ultimate price for it. Judgment came the next day. Now behold, if the Lord should make windows, and he was mocking God. He was saying, you're ridiculous. You know, some people have scientific minds and they think logically and they can't believe that God can do certain things, and oh, you're stupid because you believe this and believe that. Have faith in God, my brother and my sister. There is nothing that God can do. And he said, behold, thou shalt see it with thine eyes, but thou shalt not eat it thereof. And so it fell out unto him, for the people did what? Trod upon him in the gate, and guess what happened to him?
He died.
He what?
He
was trampled to death. He was in charge of the gate. You know what his job was? To control the crowd so they go orderly, through the gate. But guess what? When hungry people smell food, watch out! People hungry! People starving! People locked up in the place for so long they want to get out! So they run out like crazy. They say, people tired of being under lockdown in their house for this corona thing. So as soon as open the beach, they don't care, they just run the beach, and everybody, they have to lock back the beach down because people don't like to be cooped up in their houses. It is crazy. I don't know why I cope with my wife at home all day. Jesus. I'm learning to love her more. You know, some people marriage gets sweeter now because they're at home, because they never pay attention to their family. Otherwise, now they have to spend time with their family. Amen. Hallelujah. No, me and my wife get along. Don't worry about it. She don't love give me too much orders. That's how they get into my brains now. Take this upstairs. Take the garbage out. Remember to do that. Lord, I said, yes, dear, yes, dear, yes, dear. I'll do it when I'm ready. Then she want to cause me to go outside now to go cut grass. You know the grass cutting more. God, no, I'm not in the grass cutting mood right now, but it's going to happen because I'm there most of the time. And she remind me, you know, weren't we supposed to have a project yesterday? That's the part that's driving me nuts right now. So, she have a style. When she want me to take stuff upstairs, she put down the stairs. And, of course, she don't check to see me carry the stuff upstairs. So she asked me, did you take the stuff upstairs? I said, no, it walked by itself. Amen. I'm done. I'm closing. The last scripture I'm going to give you before I say goodbye is Psalm 78, verse 18. God has a problem with his children, and that problem is not going to be solved until we go to heaven. We always not believe God 100%. We always doubt God. Psalm 78 verse 18 says, and they tempted God in their heart by asking meat for their lust. And they said, when God gave them meat, they said, hey, they spake against God. They said, can God furnish a table in the wilderness? Can God do this? God upset, man. Don't cox God if you can do something. You won't get God mad. God said, there's nothing I can't do. Why can't you believe me? Then God says, behold, he smote the rock that the waters gushed out and the streams overflowed. Then they say, all right, you put water, you give me water, you give me meat. But then they say, can you give me bread also? Can he provide flesh for his people? These are questions that are questions of doubt and unbelief. Therefore, the Bible says, the Lord heard this and was wroth. That word wroth means angry. So a fire was kindled against Jacob, and anger also came up against Israel. Because what? This is the problem that God had with his people. Because they what? Believe not in God and trusted not in his salvation. Church, hear me today. If you don't get anything from what I'm saying to you today, the Bible says, believe in the Lord your God, so shall you be established. Believe his prophets, and so shall you prosper. Your believing will depend on your success with God. And I'm talking about the word, with God. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. I'm coming to the end of the service. Thank you for tuning in. Only believe. Only believe. All things are possible. Only believe. Only believe. Only believe. All things are possible. Only believe. Lord, I believe. Every fear, every unbelief that is in the hearts of your children this morning will be removed and be replaced with faith, strong faith, faith in a God who cannot fail, faith in a God that is all-powerful, omnipresent, and omniscient, faith in a God that loves us unconditionally, faith in a God who is doing everything for our best and for our good, faith in a God who says, I will never leave you nor forsake you. Father, I pray that you'll give us more grace to trust you and to believe you more and to seek your face and put your words in our hearts and our minds. Bless everyone who is listening to me this morning. Father, whatever their needs are, I pray that you will bless them, O God. Touch those that are sick in their bodies and heal them. Touch those who need a refreshing this morning. Touch those who need guidance, who need comfort, who need help, who need strength. Whatever their needs are, Father, I pray as your priest, as your servant this morning, that you will meet them at the point of their need. Bless them, O God, and keep them. Watch over them in the mighty name of Jesus. And those who are here, as we travel back home, we cut off all accident, all incident, and every assignment. We cover our cars with the blood of Jesus. And Lord, we thank you for a blessed day. Bless this week, O God. Grant us your divine favor. Grant us, O God, hallelujah, your blessings in Jesus' name. And the church said,
amen.
May the love of God and the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit rest, remain, and abide in you now forevermore. In Jesus' name. And the church said,
amen.
God bless you.